إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهديه الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين وسلم تسليما كثيرا. أما بعد، It is very natural feeling it is very natural, I'm sorry, to hate anyone who opposes the sunnah, or it is a very natural feeling to hate someone who opposes the sunnah and the hadith of Allah's messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. In fact, the one who does not hate the opposer of the sunnah is abnormal. He's got a problem, and his faith is weak and shabby. It's not really good. Is it loving what Allah loves and hating what Allah hates a foundational principle in our deen? It is. Loving what Allah loves, hating what Allah hates is part and parcel of our deen. I will quote some narrations to support that, because some people think you're being extreme, because what they prefer is love. You should love everyone irrespective of their religion, their faith, their obedience or disobedience. Everyone deserves some love. And that is incorrect. And I will prove it to you from the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the hadith which was collected by At-Tirmidhi, hadith of Mu'adh ibn Anas radiyallahu anhu, authenticated by Sheikh Al-Albani. It's a long hadith, not really long, but the part which I will quote is, مَنْ أَعْطَى لِلَّهِ وَأَحَبَّ لِلَّهِ وَأَبْغَضَ لِلَّهِ فَقَدْ اسْتَكْمَلَ الْإِيمَانِ. Whosoever gives for the sake of Allah, loves for the sake of Allah, and hates for the sake of Allah, has completed his faith, has perfected his faith. I mean, faith will not be perfect until you give for the sake of Allah, withhold for the sake of Allah, love for the sake of Allah, and hate for the sake of Allah. In a hadith of Bara ibn Azib, which is in the Musnad of Imam Ahmad, also authenticated by Sheikh Al-Albani rahimahullah, he said, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, أَوْثَقَ عُرَى الْإِيمَانِ أَلْحُبُّ فِي اللَّهِ وَالْبُغْضُ فِي اللَّهِ. The strongest aspect of your faith is loving for the sake of Allah and hating for the sake of Allah. The strongest thing which you hold on to, فَقَدْ اسْتَمْسَكَ بِالْعُرْوَةِ الْوُثْقَى أَوْثَقَ عُرَى الْإِيمَانِ. The strongest thing you hold on to is loving for the sake of Allah and hating for the sake of Allah. Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah said, إِنَّ تَحْقِيقَ شَهَادَةَ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ يَقْتَدِي أَنْ يُحِبَّ أَنْ لَا يُحِبَّ إِلَّا لِلَّهِ وَلَا يُبْغِدْ إِلَّا لِلَّهِ وَلَا يُعَادِي إِلَّا لِلَّهِ وَلَا يُوَادْ إِلَّا لِلَّهِ وَأَنْ يُحِبَّ مَا أَحَبَّ اللَّهُ وَيُبْغِدُ مَا أَبْغَضَ اللَّهُ فِي مَجْمُوعِ الْفَتَاوَى. ذكره رحمه الله. Shaykh al-Islam said, the materialization of your declaration of La ilaha illallah is that you do not love anything except for the sake of Allah, nor do you hate anything except for the sake of Allah, nor do you show affection to anyone except for the sake of Allah, nor do you show hatred towards anyone except for the sake of Allah, and that you love what Allah loves and you hate what Allah hates. And Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu has said something along the same lines before as well. Meaning this was something established. Loving for the sake of Allah, hating for the sake of Allah. So, and what is it? What does it mean? You love what Allah loves, and you hate what Allah hates. So when Allah says in the Quran, He hates such and such and such and such, you have to hate them as well. Now, if someone combines good and bad, some say you love the person and you hate their action. No. Rather, you hate them according to the evil which they are upon. And you love them according to the good which they are upon. It's not about, you cannot love someone and hate their action. Because that means that you will not treat them differently, because you have love all the time. And you hate their deed. Well, you can't deal with their deed. It's not like their deed is a separate entity which you can, you know, box with. Whatever they're doing is, well, you can't deal with it. What you can deal is with the doer. So this idea that people say, don't hate the person, hate the action, is also incorrect. Rather, hate the person according to his disobedience and opposition to to the sunnah and love them according to the good. Obviously, no one is perfect. So we have to be balanced also. Can't hate someone all the way because of some sin they commit. And you can't love someone all the way if they go against the sunnah. It must be according to what is pleasing to Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. So if one of us has an issue with this principle that I just mentioned, let him blame himself. Don't blame and don't have issues with the ones who live by it. Don't have problems with the one who loves for the sake of Allah or the one who loves what Allah loves and hates what Allah hates. If you don't feel this strong, blame yourself for your shortcomings. But don't think that someone who is adhering to the religion in this fashion is a fundamentalist or an extremist. He's not. He's following the teachings of our righteous predecessors. We say we have a problem. We haven't reached that level of faith where we're able to love what Allah loves and hate what Allah hates. Because some people love those who Allah hates. I mean, we know already Allah hates the arrogant and He hates the prideful and He hates the mutakabbir. He hates a number of people that Allah mentions in the Quran, the disbelievers. So how can we love someone whom Allah Azza wa Jalla hates? Unless the iman is weak, it is not possible. If the iman is sound, then it is possible. It has to do with our iman. Now, what I was referring to earlier was the hatred for someone who opposes the sunnah in some regards, who opposes the sunnah, or engages in sins or innovations. How would we feel then about someone who denies the sunnah altogether? Someone who denies the sunnah altogether and does not believe in its authority. Did you know that these people exist? Yes. And they are called Al-Qur'aniyun. Sometimes Al-Qur'aniyin, depending on where it comes in the sentence. Qur'anites. Or they call themselves Ahlul Qur'an. Supposedly, they are the people who follow the Qur'an. And some people think that, you know, we're talking about, you know, some minority, you know, somewhere living on Jupiter, and that we're not really in contact with them. Then think again. These creatures are around. They are around. I've come across them myself personally in my short lifespan. I'm not 80 years old. Not yet, at least, alhamdulillah. In this short lifespan, I've come across plenty. Plenty. This is live contact. Don't ask about now through the YouTube comments and the Facebook and the email and all the modern means of communication. Then you're in contact now with people all over the world and you hear the amazing, amazing accusations, allegations and lies of these people. I remember when one guy was wearing a golden ring and he was advised not to wear it. And he said, show me where it is in the Quran. Show me an ayah which says that wearing gold rings is haram for men, I will take it off. If you can't bring it, then I'm not going to take it off because it's not haram. Say, yeah, but the Messenger of Allah said, so no. I said, show me in the Quran. Yep. These people have websites. Don't go there. Don't go there. And I must make this a point. You have to understand that the shaitan is ever chasing you. Ever chasing you. And the two paths from which he can attack you is either your desires, shahawat, or shubuhat, doubt, by casting doubt. And if you're not fortified with knowledge, if you're not firm, if you don't have certainty concerning the subject matters, if you expose yourself to some of the doubts, you may be the first victim. You may be the first victim. And this happened many times. People said, brother, I was debating with the Shia, and then they told me something which I can't answer. So can you please explain? Well, I don't have to. What were you doing there to begin with? If you're not qualified to be debating with them, then you shouldn't be there. Because if they turn the tables around, and they cast it out, and no one is able to answer for you, what's going to happen? This will remain with you. Allah knows how long, and it may be the reason why you become a Shia and leave the Sunnah. This happens all the time. So when I speak about them, don't go get too curious right now and go look them up online, because they may cast some doubt. And if al-bayan fi sihr, in speech, in the eloquence of people, there's magic. They will give you evidences which make it seem like they're upon something. And if you don't know the refutations, you will get lost. But their websites are there by the hundreds, calling to the same ideology. So let us go back to the dictionary. What does philosopher or philosophy mean according to the dictionary? I'll give you two definitions. There are maybe a lot more, maybe around eight usually, the eight main definitions. But I'll give you two to show you why the Quranites, or at least Qurani people, the actual term or the noun philosophy applies to them, philosophers. It says philosophy is the investigation of knowledge based on logical reasoning rather than empirical, verifiable methods. Again, investigation of knowledge. To investigate knowledge. Based on what? Logical reasoning. Rather than empirical methods. Empirical means verifiable. Meaning they're not going back to the textual evidences, no. They will evaluate it according to their reasoning, even though they have no reason whatsoever. And according to what they say, this is their opinion, this is their philosophy. And if we understand it like this, they're basically turning away from the revelation and imposing their mind on what makes sense and what doesn't make sense. Subsequently, they become philosophers. The other definition, it says, a personal outlook or viewpoint. And that's exactly what it is. Denying the Sunnah is nothing more than their personal outlook and viewpoint. Their philosophical understanding of the revelation, which is rejected in Islam. It's rejected in Islam. Now, these wicked creatures have hundreds of websites, like I told you earlier, and great numbers of followers. It's not a minority. They claim to, and they say in the website, we follow the Quran. No more, no less. Wow! Isn't that an attractive slogan? We follow the Quran. No more, no less. Is that acceptable, Ya Akhwan? Can you say you follow the Quran, no more, no less? La ilaha illallah. Everybody has a reputation, but let's listen to what the ulama have to say concerning this. The Sunnah to them is unreliable. It is not a reference. You know what's amazing? That this is a prophecy of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He foretold this per Allah's revelation to him, obviously, 1400 years ago. In an authentic narration, he said, alayhi salatu wasalam, hadith is the hadith of Miqdam. It's in al-Hakim, al-Tirmidhi, and Ibn Majah, sahih. He said, يُوشِكُ أَحَدُكُمْ أَن يُكَذِّبَنِي وَهُوَ مُتَّكِئٌ يُحَدَّثُ بِحَدِيثِ فَيَقُولُ بَيْنَنَا وَبَيْنَكُمْ كِتَابُ اللَّهِ كِتَابُ اللَّهِ فَمَا وَجَدْنَا فِيهِ مِنْ حَلَالٍ اسْتَحْلَلْنَاهُ وَمَا وَجَدْنَا فِيهِ مِنْ حَرَامٍ حَرَّمْنَاهُ أَلَا إِنَّمَا حَرَّمَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ مِثْلَ مَا حَرَّمَ اللَّهُ. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, soon one of you will belie me while he is reclining on his couch. يُحَدَّثُ بِحَدِيثِ. Someone will quote to him my narration. Someone will narrate unto him my narration, and he will say to you, between us and you is the book of Allah. Whatever you find halal in there, we will make it halal. And whatever you find haram in there, we will make it haram. Then the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam refuted by saying, verily, whatever the Messenger of Allah made haram is equal to what Allah made haram. What the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made haram is equal, ithn, is the same like what Allah made haram. This is a prophecy. Soon this person will come, he will say, yushik, yani from, the time is not going to be too long. Say, well, you know, I don't know. Between us is the book of Allah. And so you find that, according to them, half of the deen is gone, if not more. How are you going to pray? How are you going to fast? How will you pay zakah? How will you perform hajj? How will you perform umrah? How? What about the rulings which we learn from the sunnah? All the teachings for men and women which we learn from the sunnah. The behavior of the Prophet ﷺ which we learn from the sunnah. The treatment of the wives, the rights of the children. The whole deen comes from the general explanation of the Quran, the specific explanation of the Sunnah, of the general teaching in the Quran. So to claim that there is no such thing is outrageous, and it leaves you with nothing. It leaves you with nothing. And furthermore, they believe that the Quran is not someone's, it's not the right of some people to do tafsir. No, no, anyone can do tafsir. Anyone, if you can grab the Quran and deduce your own rulings, like the Quran, because supposedly the Quran is this for everyone. So there's no, they don't make that distinction between the knowledgeable and the ignorant. Everything goes. With no sunnah, there's no more Islam. Now, you may wonder, where did they come from? They were a minority of them. Some of them say it was the Khawarij, some say it was the Mu'tazila. At the time of Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah in this second century, a bare minority, Imam Shafi'i refuted them and they died out. They died out until a couple of hundred years ago, the 1900s, in the colonization of the British colonization to the Indian subcontinent. Basically, they took over that area. And of course, the Hindus and the Christians, everybody else had no problem in going along with everything that the British were imposing. The only ones whom they found resistance amongst, and they were, you know, persevered, they persevered, were the Muslims. As usual, the Muslims weren't willing to give up their deen for the British, you know, imposing on them whatever values and views and what have you that contradicted the teachings of Islam. And so there's this, you know, very, you know, effective but dangerous concept called, if you can't beat them, join them. And it works. It works every single time. Anywhere you go, until today, it works. If you can't beat them, join them. Go inside and destroy them from within. Just like Paul did to Christianity. He couldn't beat them. I mean, he was torturing them, but he can't torture a whole nation. He can't torture a whole, you know, the whole adherence of Christianity. So suddenly he became, you know, the apostle Paul, and suddenly he saw Jesus, and suddenly there's a new concept in Christianity other than the one that Jesus taught. So God became his son, and incarnation, and he became one of three in the Father. All these things came partially because of Paul's claim. The same thing that Abdullah ibn Sabah, the Jewish hypocrite, who also entered into Islam with the intention to destroy Islam from within. It's the same idea. You can't beat them, join them. So they did the same thing. And from them came Sayyid Ahmad Khan, the wicked. And from them came Ghulam Ahmad and the Qadianis. And from them came Rashad Khalifa. And all these people who pushed this idea of putting away the Sunnah and supposedly sticking to the Quran. So they are the ones who revived this ideology. And then of course in Egypt, they picked up on it, and then they were propagators in Egypt as well among the Arabs. And so now you have among the Arabs and the non-Arabs people pushing for this idea that all you need in your life is the Quran, the Sunnah is unreliable, subsequently you cannot refer to it, and so Islam became the Quran only. And there was no more Sunnah of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What are their beliefs? The first thing they say, which is crazy, is that there's no such thing as naskh. There's no such thing as abrogation. Now look at the contradiction and the hypocrisy. They say we follow the Quran only, and the Quran says, مَا نَنْسَخْ مِنْ آيَةٍ أَوْ نُنْسِهَا نَأْتِ بِغَيْرٍ مِنْهَا أَوْ مِثْلِهَا. We don't abrogate an ayah, nor do we cause it to be forgotten, except that we bring one which is better than it or like it. So in the very text of the Quran, Allah Azza wa Jalla spoke about the abrogation of ayat, abrogating others. But according to them, there is no such thing as abrogation. And we know that there is. Otherwise, if there is no such thing as abrogation, you can get out of this hall and get drunk. You know that? Because in the beginning, the ayat about khamr were not that of prohibition. And there are ayat in the Quran which actually say that don't go pray. Don't go pray while you are intoxicated until you know what you're saying. So if someone doesn't believe the last ayah, which is فَأَلْأَنْتُمْ مُنْتَهُونَ, abrogated the previous one, then it remains effective, then you can still get drunk. And the list goes on and on and on. So the dangers of denying abrogation is outrageous. And they claim that there's no such thing, but it's in the Quran. So that tells you how much of the Quran they're following. But that's not the worst thing. The worst thing is they say the Sunnah is not authoritative. The Sunnah is not authoritative. Fine. So then how do we understand the following? How do we understand the statement of Allah, وَمَا أَتَاكُمُ الرَّسُولُ فَخُذُوهُ وَمَا نَهَاكُمْ عَنْهُ فَانْتَهُوا وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهُ. Whatever the messenger gives you, take it. And whatever he forbids you, leave it alone. Desist. Stop. And fear Allah, verily Allah is severe in punishment. Time out. If the Sunnah was not authoritative, then how would you apply whatever the messenger gives you, take it? Because if they claim that whatever the messenger gave was the Quran only, then the ayah wouldn't make sense. The ayah wouldn't be in this form. It would be whatever is in the Quran, take it. Whatever is not, leave it alone. No. But the ayah says, whatever the messenger gives you, whatever he forbids you. Where are you going to know what he gave and forbade? Because what's in the Quran is what Allah gave and forbade, not the messenger of Allah. Isn't it? In the Quran is what Allah said, do and don't. But the messengers, his do's and don'ts, where are you going to get them from? The Sunnah. So how will you then follow, how will you claim that the Sunnah is not authoritative and apply this ayah? This ayah becomes meaningless and void. But that, not only this ayah. How would you apply the ayah وَمَا اخْتَلَفْتُمْ فِيهِ مِنْ شَيْءٍ فَرُدُّوهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَالرَّسُولِ. Whatever you differ concerning, then return it to Allah and His Messenger. Now we know returning it to Allah is returning it to what? The Book of Allah. Isn't it? Okay, how would you return it to the Messenger of Allah? How would you apply this ayah? Ayah number 3. Allah says, يَوْمَئِذٍ يَوَدُّ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا وَعَصَوُوا الرَّسُولَ لَوْ تُسَوَّى بِهِمُ الْأَرْضِ وَلَا يَكْتُمُونَ اللَّهَ حَدِيثًا. On that day, those who disbelieved and disobeyed the messenger will wish that they were buried in the earth, but they will never be able to hide a single fact from Allah. How will this ayah apply? How did they disobey the messenger? How did they disobey? Because disbelief, we know they rejected the Quran. How did they do the ma'asiyah of the Rasul? It is impossible if there wasn't a sunnah. Fourthly, Allah says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَطِيعُوا اللَّهَ وَأَطِيعُوا الرَّسُولُ وَأُولِي الْأَمْرِ مِنْكُمْ. Oh, you have believed, obey Allah and obey His Messenger. Obeying Allah, but we obey the Quran. Obey the Messenger is how? If they say it's also obeying the Quran, that's redundant. That's redundant. It's repeating something for no benefit. Obey Allah, find the Quran. They say that obey the Messenger also means obey the Quran. Why? It doesn't make any sense. Now, fifthly, وَإِذَا قِيلَ لَهُمْ تَعَالَوْا إِلَى مَا أَنزَلَ اللَّهُ وَإِلَى الرَّسُولِ رَأَيْتَ الْمُنَافِقِينَ يَصُدُّونَ عَنْكَ صُدُودًا. And when it is said to them, come to what Allah has revealed and to the Messenger, you see the hypocrites turning away from you in aversion. And that's exactly what these people are doing. When it said, come to Allah and His Messenger, the hypocrites turn away, meaning they don't want to go back to the Sunnah of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because the hypocrites. FYI, the Quranites are kuffar. The scholars have no dispute about their kufr. There's no dispute about their disbelief. These people we're speaking about, they're not Muslims. Not Muslims. Not Muslims. Not Muslims. Because all these ayat they're belying the ayat of the Quran. And we will see more. Don't get ahead of yourself. Furthermore, Allah says, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا مِنْ رَسُولٍ إِلَّا لِيُطَاعَ بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ. And we have not sent a messenger except that he is to be obeyed by the permission of Allah. Meaning the messenger has to obey. How would you obey the messenger if there was no sunnah? Allah says, وَمَنْ يُطِعَ الرَّسُولَ فَقَدْ أَطَاعَ اللَّهِ. Whosoever obeys the messenger has obeyed Allah. How would you understand this ayah if there was no sunnah? You see where I'm going. And lastly, Allah Azza wa Jalla says, وَأَطِيعُوا اللَّهَ وَأَطِيعُوا الرَّسُولَ وَاحْذَرُوا. فإن توليتم فاعلموا أنما على رسولنا البلاغ المبين. Obey Allah and obey His Messenger and be careful. If you turn away, then verily upon the Messenger is the responsibility of the clear clarification only. And in Surah Al-Shu'ara, واخفض جناحك لمن اتبعك من المؤمنين فإن عصوك فقل إني بريء مما تعملون. And lower your wing to those who follow you among the believers. And if they disobey you, say, verily, I am innocent of whatever you are doing. So in asawka, they disobey you. Meaning when you command them and they disobey you. Again, all of these will become ineffective. Anyways, Allah Azza wa Jalla had already also prophesied and told us about, hinted at this by saying in the following ayah, يَا أَيُّهَا الرَّسُولُ لا يحزنك الذين يسارعون في الكفر من الذين قالوا آمنا بأفواههم ولم تؤمن قلوبهم ومن الذين هادوا سماعون للكذب سماعون لقوم آخرين لم يأتوك يحرفون الكلم عن بعض مواضعه يقولون إن أوتيتم هذا فخذوه وإن لم تؤتوه فاحذروا ومن يرد الله فتنته فلن تملك له من الله شيئا أولئك الذين لم يرد الله أن يطهر قلوبهم لهم في الدنيا خزي ولهم في الآخرة عذاب أليم. Listen to this ayah. O messenger, let them not grieve you who hasten into disbelief of those who say we believe with their mouths but their hearts believe not. Nor, and from among the Jews, also from among the Jews, they are avid listeners to falsehood, listening to another people who have not come to you. They distort words beyond their proper usages, saying, if you are given this, take it. But if you are not given, then beware. But he for whom Allah intends fitna, pay attention. He for whom Allah intends fitna, never will you possess any power for him to do against Allah. No power for him to think against Allah. You can't do anything. If Allah intends to send someone astray, there's nothing which you can do to keep him upon the deen. Then Allah said, those are the ones for whom Allah does not intend to purify their hearts. And that's the scary part. The ulama said, this is one of the scariest ayat. If Allah doesn't intend to purify our hearts, who will do it? No one. You can't do it on your own. Your friends can't do it. Your family can't do it. Your wife can't do it. Your husband can't do it. No one can do it. Allah is the one. يُزَكِّي مَنْ يَشَاءُ. And if Allah doesn't want to purify our hearts, we are destroyed. This is why salah is not a habit. It is not Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. It is not. Because if you don't mean what you're saying, then you're not going to get what you want. How is Allah going to purify your heart when you don't even know what you're saying in the Fatiha? The Fatiha is the source of purification. If you mean what you say in the Fatiha, you praise Allah, and you mention His majesty, and you glorify Him, and you praise Him, then you mention that you need Him, and you worship Him alone, then you beg Him for guidance, the guidance of the righteous, and you tell Him to keep you from the path of those who are astray. This is a comprehensive dua, nothing better than that. 17 times a day minimum, 40 times on average if you pray the sunnah. So if we were to think about that, that is enough for the purification of the heart. Because if Allah doesn't want to purify the heart, and if Allah wants to send someone astray with a fitna, He's done. This is why we have to be always begging Allah, be careful, be careful. Don't get carried away. We get carried away with our sins. We all do. But we have to be careful. We have to know when to stop. And when we fall into the sin, repent to Allah, change. Don't get comfortable. Don't get comfortable. Once you start sinning and you get comfortable with it and you no longer feel remorseful, then this is already, we're already going in the direction where the purification of the heart may become something absent. So it is very necessary that we are in Allah yuhibbu tawwabin. Allah loves those who constantly repent to Him. We all sin, the speaker and the listeners. But as long as we must always repent to Allah. If we don't, akhwan, we are in big trouble. The ayah, this ayah is scary. For them in this world is disgrace, and for them in the hereafter is a great, great punishment. So Allah Azza wa Jalla is telling the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, don't grieve over these people who say they believe with their mouths and they really don't believe in their hearts. And they reject the things which come from the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, like these people and the Jews. Now, let us refute them. Let us refute them. These are the ayat I quoted to show you that according to them, these ayat become meaningless, ineffective, inapplicable, void, invalid. You name it. Think about the words. These ayat become nothing according to them, because all of them necessitate obeying the messenger, returning to the messenger, listening to the messenger, one against disobeying the messenger, and then it goes on. If there was no sunnah, all of this wouldn't be there. It would have been قال الله and the Quran in its end. It's the end of it. But let us refute them. شيخ الألباني رحمه الله تعالى وأدخله فسيح جناته وأسكنه في الدرس الأعلى رحمه الله, the one who defended the sunnah with his life until he died رضي الله عنه. We can say رضي الله عنه by the way. ورحمه الله, because may Allah be pleased with them. Here in the goal of the masjid, if you give an old man something, he says Allah يرضى عليك. Same thing, may Allah be pleased with you. I don't mean it in any other way. رحمه الله, you know the sheikh. I'm not going to give you a bio of the sheikh and introduce him. Everybody should be, anyone who loves the sunnah should know of Sheikh Al-Albani. Yet we say we're not blind followers of anyone. We're not Albanis, as in only Albani, nothing else goes. No. We still take from all the ulama which propagate and love the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. We don't have any blind or any attachment to any particular one while withholding from the others or abandoning the others. Even though this is a quality and characteristic of some people today. There are three scholars that they take from today, and everybody else can take a hike according to them. No one else is qualified, no one else is speed, no one else is that. This is extreme in our deen. We're not restricted to a few. Plenty of ulama upon the sunnah. Yes, those who made errors in some areas, we abandon the errors, no doubt. No doubt, not everyone is always perfect, no one. Not even the four imams of the hadaih, obviously. But we have our balance. Someone's upon the sunnah with some mistakes, ignore the mistakes, take from him. Not he makes a mistake, khalas, put a big old X on him, you know, he's done. It's the X list. He's off the manhaj, brother. Yes, he's off the manhaj. We'll see who's off the manhaj at the end of the day. Now, the Shaykh rahimahullah had a nice refutation to these people. He said, quoting or commenting on the ayah, Allah says, وَأَنزَلْنَا إِلَيْكَ الذِّكْرَ لِتُبَيِّنَ لِلنَّاسِ مَا نُزِّلَ إِلَيْهِمْ وَلَعَلَّهُمْ يَتَفَكَّرُونَ. Remember this ayah, memorize it, understand it. Allah Azza wa Jalla says, and we revealed to you the message. Listen carefully. We revealed to you the message that you may make clear to the people what was sent down to them, and that they might give thought. Chapter 18 or Surah 16, Afwan, ayah number 44. Read Surah An-Nahl. Listen. I will repeat. And we revealed to you the message that you may make clear to the people what was sent down to them. Now, what is the message which Allah sent? The Quran. And what? The Sunnah. The Quran, we know it already. Who will make clear to the people what's in the Quran through His Sunnah? The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And Allah said that He sent down the Quran so that you may make clear to the people. According to them, the Quran is clear already. There is nothing which requires further clarification. If this is the case, then again this ayah cannot be understood. If the Quran was clear, then why did Allah say, so you may make clear to the people? So you can make clear to the people what, you know, Allah revealed. It wouldn't be necessary, because according to them, it's already clear. Ajeeb. The Shaykh said, this ayah consists of two types. The term, لِتُبَيِّن. لِتُبَيِّن لِلنَّاسِ, explanation. So you may explain. The Shaykh said they consist of two types of explanation. First, an explanation of its wording and their arrangement. This means conveying the Quran and not conceding it, and persisting and presenting to the people just as Allah revealed it to his heart. عَلَى قَلْبِكَ لِتَكُونَ مِنَ الْمُنْذِرِينَ. So here it means, according to the first tafsir of لِتُبَيِّنَ لِلنَّاسِ, meaning you convey the Quran as Allah revealed it unto you. In the order which we know it today. The order in which we know it today. The order of the surah, and the order of the ayat in the surah, and the order of the words in the ayat. All of them, this is part of the tibyan of the Prophet ﷺ to the ummah. the second explanation of the meaning of the word of the sentence or the verse that the ummah needs an explanation of the meaning of the word. The meaning of the word. Or the sentence. Or the verse that the ummah needs to have explained. This occurs a majority of the time with the ambiguous mujmal. In Arabic it's called mujmal. Ambiguous, عام, general, and mutlaq, absolute. The absolute verses. We have عام, we have المطلق, and we have المجمل. آيات in the Quran. So the Sunnah came to clarify the ambiguous, make specific the general, and restrict the absolute. The Sunnah came to clarify the ambiguous, make specific or specify the general, and restrict the absolute, the mutlaq. Examples. Allah says, وَالسَّارِقُ وَالسَّارِقَةُ فَقَطَعُوا أَيْدِيَهُمَا. The male and the female thief cut off their hands. Al-Yad. Now, this is Surah Al-Ma'idah, Ayah 38. This is a good example here. The word thief, sariq, if I put this tissue here, and one of the young kids came and took it, technically speaking, did he steal it or not? Is he a thief or not? Yes. It doesn't matter what you take. Linguistically, you have stolen something. Even if you, in fact, you can say to someone who's smoking, you stole my fresh air. I was breathing fresh air until you came, and you stole my fresh air which I was breathing. Technically speaking, linguistically. But, Islamically, is this the case? No. The Prophet ﷺ said in his verbal sunnah, that there's no cutting off of the hand except in cases where one steals a quarter of a dinar or more. So this video which they were circulating among the Christians, and I've received it many times from the Christians, they show you some people in Iran bringing a young 7-year-old child, more or less, and they have his arm under a truck. Okay? And they show you the truck running over his arm to chop it off, and they say because they caught him stealing an apple from the grocery store. The Christians da'wah. They say, look at Islam. This is Islam. Now according to Islam, this boy first is under the age of discretion, he's not reliable. Number two, he stole an apple, and that does not constitute a quarter of a dinar. Thirdly, you don't run it over with a truck to chop it off, because you will take his whole arm. The Sunnah specified that what you will cut off is from the wrist. From the wrist. And doing other than that is oppression. And the term aidi has different meanings. Because Fir'aun said, لَأَقَطِعَنَّ أَيْدِيَكُمْ وَأَرْجُلَكُمْ مِنْ خِلَافٍ. And according to some, it means he will chop off their whole arm. So the term yet could refer to the wrist, the arm, or even the palm. In tayammum, Allah mentioned, فَمْسَحُوا بِوُجُوهِكُمْ وَأَيْدِيَكُمْ. And we know that the sunnah is that you put some dust and you wipe your face. So here yet became palm. So here we have the term yet in the Quran, or the ruling on the thief. The sunnah specified that it has to be a quarter of a dinar or more, and there are other conditions. The ulama say if it's something which you left out there, it doesn't count. It must be something which you hid somewhere, and the thief went out of his way, broke into that thing, and then stole it. If you left it, if you forgot your watch somewhere, and someone took it, the ulama say still you don't cut his hand. So the sunnah specified this. Without that, if they don't want to refer to the sunnah, then all of the children, all of you children who probably stole something from someone's house, you'll be chopping hands all day. And Muslims will be walking around with no hands. You see these crazy people, man? La ilaha illallah. They want to say that, you know, you can't go back to the sunnah. Well, you have to go back to the sunnah. Otherwise, how are you going to understand these ayat? I'll give you another example. And this one is scarier. Allah Azza wa Jalla says, الذين their belief with injustice. Look, is injustice, wrongdoing, oppression, those will have security and they are rightly guided. In the ilm of tafsir, the ulama said there's something called mafhum al-mukhalafa. Meaning when something is established, the opposite is also established without the need to be mentioned. So when Allah says, أُولَٰئِكَ لَهُمْ لَمْ, those will have security, and they are rightly guided. It means those who don't, who mix good, they are neither do they have security, nor are they rightly guided. And Allah doesn't have to say that, but when Allah says that those are like this, it means that the others are like that. Now when the Sahaba heard this ayah, they were troubled by the ayah. Allah said, those who believe and they don't mix any injustice with their iman. And those are the only ones who will have security, and those are the only ones who are rightly guided. So then, they went to the Messenger of Allah, they said, O Messenger of Allah, which one of us doesn't mix his faith with wrong? Here the Prophet ﷺ said, it doesn't mean this kind of ghulm. It only means shirk. Did you not hear the statement of Luqman? إِنَّ الشِّرْكَ لَظُلْمٌ عَظِيمٌ. Verily, shirk is great dhulm. So he's saying that this ayah here, the dhulm which the ayah is referring to is like the dhulm which Luqman was speaking about, the dhulm of shirk. This shirk is dhulm, not the regular sins. Otherwise, according to this ayah, the whole Muslim ummah is going to Jahannam. Because no one lived the perfect life from the time they reached puberty until they died. If once you mixed it with it, according to them, no heaven for you and you're not rightly guided. So it became necessary that the Prophet ﷺ explain the meaning of this ayah to the Sahaba. And Ibn Mas'ud said that they are the best of this ummah. He described the Sahaba saying they are the best of this ummah, possessing the most pious of hearts, profound in learning, and the least of constraints. But in spite of this, now this is Sheikh Al-Bani commenting, in spite of this, they erred. They made a mistake in understanding that, and it was necessary that the Prophet ﷺ gave him the correct meaning of the word dhulm in this ayah. So the sunnah what? Explains the Qur'an. It specifies that which is general. It explains what is ambiguous. The ayah was ambiguous. Dhulm could be interpreted in many different ways. Dhulm against yourself, dhulm against people, dhulm against the deen of Allah, dhulm against so on and so forth. It specified dhulm here was shirk. Meaning if you commit sins, it doesn't mean that you will not have security, nor does it mean that you're not rightly guided. So the sunnah again explained this ambiguous concept. Allah says, فَلَا وَرَبْ And there are many other examples. فَلَا وَرَبِّكَ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ حَتَّى يُحَكِّمُوكَ فِي مَا شَجَرَ بَيْنَهُمْ ثُمَّ لَا يَجِدُوا فِي أَنفُسِهِمْ حَرَجًا مِمَّا قَضَيْتَ وَيُسَلِّمُوا تَسْلِيمًا. And they, by your Lord, they shall never truly believe until they make you a judge concerning everything which they dispute about. Then they do not find within themselves any discomfort concerning your judgment, and they submit in full submission. Allah said, you will not believe until you make the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam the judge concerning everything. Meaning, you must refer back to the sunnah. Because the Qur'an will not specify some things. And if you don't refer back to the sunnah, you will never be able to find them out. Allah also says, وَمَا كَانَ لِمُؤْمِنٍ وَلَا مُؤْمِنَةٍ إِذَا قَضَى اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ أَمْرًا أَنْ يَكُونَ لَهُمُ الْخِيَرَةُ مِنْ أَمْرِهِمْ وَمَنْ يَعْصِ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ فَقَدْ ضَلَّ ضَلَالًا مُبِينًا. It is not for a believing man or a believing woman. After Allah and His Messenger have decided concerning a subject matter, have decided concerning any matter, that they should have an opinion concerning it. You're not even allowed to have an opinion once Allah or His Messenger declare something to be halal or haram. You don't even have the right of an opinion. And whoever disobeys Allah and His Messenger has went, you know, clearly astray. Clearly astray. This ayat, how will you understand it? Then furthermore, we have an ayah which we quoted earlier, and listen to the incident related to it. وَمَا أَتَاكُمُ الرَّسُولُ وَمَا نَهَاكُمْ عَنْهُ فَانْتَهُ. A woman came to Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu. She said, are you the one who said, may Allah curse الناقصة والمتنمصة والواشمة والمستوشمة الآخرين. Are you the one who said, may Allah curse the woman who plucks her eyebrows and the one who gets them plucked, the one who does it and the one who gets it done, the one who does the tattoo and the one who gets it done, and the list goes on. Are you the one who said that? He said, yes. She said, I read the Quran from its front to its back. And I did not find that in what you say. I did not find in the Quran what you're saying, that Allah curses, you know, the namisa and mutanamisa. He responded, he said, if you have truly read it, you would have found it. Did you not read, وَمَا أَتَاكُمُ الرَّسُولُ فَقُذُوهُ وَمَا نَهَاكُمْ عَنْهُ فَانْتَهُ وَتَقُوا اللَّهَ إِنَّ اللَّهَ شَدِيدُ الْعِقَابِ. She said, of course. He said, then I indeed heard the Messenger of Allah say, May Allah's curse be upon the woman that plucks the eyebrows and the one who asks for it until the end. The hadith is reported by Bukhari and Muslim. Meaning Ibn Mas'ud was saying, look, the Messenger of Allah cursed. Allah said, generally obey Allah. Whatever the Messenger of Allah gives you, take it. Whatever he forbids you, leave it alone. Now, this is a practical application of his following of the Sunnah. Allah simply said, do that, and the Messenger of Allah said that, so I do what the Messenger of Allah did. He cursed them, and I say, may Allah curse them. And we say, may Allah curse them, because we do what the Prophet ﷺ told us to do. We follow him in all of these areas. Now, let us review them from the narrations. The Prophet ﷺ said, أَلَا إِنِّي أُوتِيتُ الْكِتَابِ وَمِثْلُهُ مَعَهُ. Verily, I have been given the book and that which is equal to it with it. And this is the sunnah, his sunnah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and this hadith sahih Abu Dawood. Furthermore, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, مَنْ أَطَاعَنِي فَقَدْ أَطَاعَ اللَّهِ. Whosoever obeys me has obeyed Allah, وَمَنْ عَصَانِي فَقَدْ عَصَى اللَّهِ. And whosoever disobeys me has disobeyed Allah. This is the hadith of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this is in Bukhari Muslim. In Sahih Bukhari, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, كل أمتي يدخلون الجنة إلا من أبى. قالوا ومن يأبى يا رسول الله. قال من أطاعني دخل الجنة ومن عصاني فقد أبى. He said, all of my ummah will enter Jannah except those who disobey me. Except those who refuse, actually. Those who refuse or reject. He said, who will refuse or reject the Messenger of Allah? He said, whoever obeys me will enter Jannah. Whoever disobeys me has rejected. Whoever disobeys me has refused. Alayhi salatu wasalam. So these are narrations further fortifying the Quranic ayat about the harmony between obeying Allah and obeying His Messenger. Obeying Allah is following the Quran. Obeying the Messenger is following the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which explains the Quran. Furthermore, Bukhari Muslim, he said in Hajjat al-Wada, in the final farewell pilgrimage, he said, alayhi salatu wasalam, فَلْيُبَلِّغِ الشَّاهِدِ الغائب, that the one who is present convey this to the one who is absent. So he commanded them to convey his message, his speech to the people. He's commanded the people to convey his sunnah, because he was giving khutbah. He was giving khutbah. And the khutbah was not all the ayat of the Quran. It was the ayat of the Quran with his own instructions, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he commanded the people to convey it to the rest. So those who claim otherwise are simply wild. Now, but they say, they say, look, that's nice. But the sunnah, the hadith, we have problems with it. We have weak hadith, sahih hadith, fabricated hadith, or your own admission. You admit. We admit. So they say, because of this doubt, because of the existence of this doubt, it is better to be safe and leave it alone. We say, wow, this is a very strange approach. And through which means do you think the Qur'an came to you? This Qur'an, wasn't it through the chain of narrators? It's the same methodology. It's the same methodology. How did you get the Qur'an? Did Allah reveal a book? A physical book? No, He did not. If Allah revealed the book, then we will say, okay, the Qur'an has its own way of coming. The Qur'an and the Sunnah came through the same way. Except that in the beginning, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not want the people to write his speech. Pay attention. In the beginning, he did not want the people to write his speech. And this is one of the evidences they use. Now listen to this. And this is in Muslim, in the Sahih, and Sahih Abu Sa'id الخدري، لحديث أبي سعيد الخدري. The Prophet ﷺ said, لا تكتبوا عني شيئا إلا القرآن ومن كتب عني شيئا فلينحه. He said, do not write anything from me except the Quran. And if you write anything other than that, erase it. Hadith what? Sahih. Do you believe it? We do. Do we deny like they do? We don't. Now you know what's amazing? One of the funniest things in the world is that they use this hadith to claim that you don't have to believe in hadith. Live. Majnun? You must be Majnun. If you say that this hadith is sahih and you should go by his teaching, you just approved hadith. How do you deny it through the same source? It's absolutely crazy. But they go with it. And people don't pay attention. This is crazy. I mean, I thought of it logically. I thought I was intelligent, honestly. It turned out that I was not. I thought, I'm like, subhanAllah, do they really use this as a hujjah? Then I saw that Shaykh Al-Bani already used the same thing. Rahimahullah, of course, he's the Shaykh. He said the same thing to them. He said, look, if you're now acknowledging the authenticity of this narration, meaning you've acknowledged the science, how are you going to deny it from the same source? Your very approval of it is a refutation against you. If you want to deny it, you have to find something else. You can't find this narration. But even that narration has an explanation. Because we have other authentic narrations, listen to them. Hadith Abu Dawood and Al-Hakim and others. Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As, he said, قُلْتُ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ إني أسمع منك الشيء فأكتبه. قال نعم. قلت في الغضب والرضا. قال نعم. فإني لا أقول فيهما إلا حقا. He said, oh Messenger of Allah, I hear something from you, so I write it down. He said, yes. He said, whether in the state of anger or in the state of being pleased. He said, yes, nothing comes out in this regard except truth. Meaning whether I'm in a state of anger for the sake of Allah, because he never got angry for himself, alayhi salallahu alayhi wa sallam, or in a state of pleasure, in either case nothing comes out of my mouth except حَقًّا وَمَا يَنْطِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَى إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٌ يُوحَى. He does not speak of his own desire, it is nothing but revelation being revealed to him. That's one sahih hadith. At-Tirmidhi narrated from hadith of Abu Hurairah, he said, كان رجل من الأنصار يجلس إلى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يسمع منه الحديث فيعجبه ولا يحفظه، يعني كان سريع النسيان. فقال له النبي استعن عليه بيمينك وأومى بيده إلى الخط. A man from the Ansar used to sit with the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم. He would listen to the narration and he would like it, but he wouldn't be able to memorize it, meaning he didn't have a strong memory. He would quickly forget. So he said this to the Messenger of Allah. The Prophet ﷺ said to him, "Ista'in alayhi biyaminik." Seek aid in the memorization with your right hand. And he gestured with the line, as in right. He gestured with the khat, right. With the khat, with the line, right on the line. The second Sahih hadith. The third hadith. And the third hadith, of course, now. They want to play games with us, right? They say, but you know, you're quoting Hakim, Abu Dawood, Tirmidhi, you know that this requires verification, authentication. We say, no problem. You want Bukhari? Here comes Bukhari for you. Bukhari, narrated in the Sahih from Abu Hurairah, radiallahu anhu, said, لم يكن أحد من أصحاب رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أكثر حديثا مني إلا ما كان من عبد الله بن عمرو بن العاص فإنه كان يكتب وأنا لا أكتب. He said رضي الله عنه, no one from among the companions of the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم had more collection of narrations than myself, more than me except, no one had more than me except Abdullah بن عمرو بن العاص. Verily he used to write and I used to not write. He used to write. And earlier the Prophet ﷺ said, write, nothing comes out except the truth, write. He commanded him to write. Abu Hurairah acknowledging that he used to write, and do you think the Messenger of Allah will say to them, erase it, and they will keep it? Do you think Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As will be told by the Messenger of Allah, erase it, and he will keep it? Impossible. They kept it. they by the instruction of the Messenger of Allah. Why? The ulama say, look, the issue is not that complicated. Oh no, 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 wait. One more hadith. Bukhari and Muslim. أن رجلا من أهل اليمن اسمه أبو شاه سمع خطبة النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم بمكة عام الفتح، وكان أميا لا يقرأ ولا يكتب، فطلب من النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أن يكتب له شيئا مما قال، فقال صلى الله عليه وسلم أصحابه اكتبوا لأبي شاه. There was a man from the people of Yemen, his name was Abu Shah. He heard the khutbah of the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم in the year of conquest in Mecca. He was illiterate, unlettered, he could neither read nor write. So he requested that the Messenger of Allah عليه الصلاة والسلام write something for him. So the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said to Sahaba, write for Abu Shah. Write down for him, because he couldn't read or write. And the Prophet ﷺ couldn't read or write alayhi salatu wasalam, and that does not affect his greatness or his nobility alayhi salatu wasalam in any way, shape, form. Rather, this is from the evidences of his prophethood. Because he brought this Quran, which no one was able to even bring a surah like, while he wasn't able to read or write. I mean, he would assume someone who was reading encyclopedias day and night and, you know, looking, he would get some knowledge. Someone who couldn't read and couldn't write would be very much limited in his resources. Yet this Quran, who until today they can't deal with, this is a sign. This is a sign of his Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The hadith of Bukhari and Muslim, Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to Sahaba, write for him. Write for him. He used to listen to the khutbah, he wanted to take some with him. So the ulama say, look, in the beginning, when the Quran was being revealed, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not want the mixture to occur. People were not yet familiar with the style of the Quran completely. They were not yet familiar. So there was fear that there would be mixture between what Allah said and what Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said. As the iman grew among the Sahaba, and they were able to make a distinction now between the speech of Allah and the speech of the Messenger of Allah, he then commanded them to write, because that is no longer an issue. So they obeyed and they wrote. This is the only thing that they have. They claim. Furthermore, ya akhwan, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has delegated through His qadar and will and mashia that ulama dedicate their lives for the preservation, study, verification, and authentication of the science. If you read the biographies of the imams who collected a hadith, beginning with Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah, Imam Ahmad, Bukhari, Muslim, Tirmidhi, Abu Dawood, Ibn Majah, Nasa'i, Ibn Abi Shaybah, ila akhirih, you are amazed at the accuracy, at the scrutinization they were upon to ensure that everything is verified, whether it is attributable to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam or not. And when Allah said, إِنَّا نَحْنُ نَزَّلْنَا الذِّكْرَ وَإِنَّا لَهُ لَحَافِظُونَ, really it is we who send down the reminder and it is we who would protect it. This included the Quran and the Sunnah, because today the Sunnah is protected. Now you try to find a quotation of any other prophet other than the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and say that I can attribute this to him, you are unable to do so. You can get the Bible and you can say that Jesus said, but do you have a chain of narration or chain of narrators going back to Jesus? No way, Jose. But you can say that this hadith was narrated from Fulan, who was thiqa, thiqt, he was firm, he was reliable, excellent memory, pious, God-fearing, who narrated to this person, to that person, to that person, that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, and then this was collected and preserved in books which remain until today. This is how Allah Azza wa Jal preserved it. So this whole idea of the existence of weak narrations or fabricated narrations only supports our case to prove to them that the hadith has been preserved to the extent that we know what the Messenger of Allah said and what the people lied against him. Otherwise it would have been all mumbo jumbo. Everyone would come to say, no, you can't come to this, so the Messenger of Allah said, we would be able to tell whether this hadith or not, whether this is sahih or not. Can't we? Yes, we can. So they have absolutely no loopholes. They're trying to, you know, they're trying to fight like a snake, trying to find this small so they can go in and try to cause doubt. They can. Anytime they come in from a door, we will shut it in their face. You cannot be a Muslim without believing in the Quran and the Sunnah. And it is illogical, nonsensical to believe otherwise. To reject them. Let me tell you in conclusion, what they want. Here's what they're aiming at. By the way, this is pro-secular, or secularism. This actually supports the Western ideology of diminishing or destroying Islam. If you can't join them, if you can't beat them, join them. So they actually, the modernists, they propagate this kind of ideology. They love it. Their aims and objectives is support of secularism and imposing it on the Muslims. You see this happening all over the place today. Secondly, support of the Shia. They support the Shia and the Sufis so that they will propagate falsehood and keep away the Muslims from the truth. And you wouldn't be shocked when Sheikh Nazim and Hamza Yusuf and all these people are on excellent terms with the governments which are killing the Muslims on a daily basis. You wouldn't be shocked if they were totally fine with them. Because it's all part of the whole plan. These people are actually predominantly agents. And we will deal with other agents not too long from now. They actually support the Qadianis. The Ahmadis. With wealth and with you things you can't believe. So that they can continue to propagate their nonsense about the Prophet coming after the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And they use sometimes people of knowledge or so-called scholars whom they purchase with fulus, and these people come, you know, and they declare the nonsense before the masses. As it has happened many times with some of the shuyukh of the Azhar, you know, at some point they were calling for mixing, you know, in the Jam'at al-Azhar. Between them, well, everything goes. Even when you're studying the deen, let it be men and women sitting next to each other, like, you know, like there's absolutely nothing wrong with it. And how do they do so? What will they lead to? They fight the niqab, which will eventually become denial of hijab. And we said already that those who say that hijab has nothing to do with the deen. They deny and put an end to many of the legal, for example, apostasy in Islam. Where do you get the ruling on that? From the Sunnah of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When they deny the Sunnah, they're able to deny struggling for the sake of Allah, jihad. They're able to deny the ruling on apostasy. They're able to deny the hijab of the woman. They're able to deny many, many different rulings will become of no value, become ineffective by simply denying the Sunnah. So once they see people with this kind of methodology and ideology, they will bring them, support them, give them masajid, give them places, give them websites, give them money, so that they will come and attack the Muslims with this nonsense. And this is why we have to be educated about these things, so we will not be fooled by these fools. So we can know our deen, and know that it is intact, it is preserved, it is protected by Allah. No one, even if the people, you know, propagate a modern approach or modern understanding of Islam, we stick to the old ways. You know, as they say, we're old school. We are old school to the bone when it comes to Islam. Modern technology, guess what? We'll use microphones, videos, you know, recorders, whatever. So in terms of the dunya, inshallah we are up to date because we don't want the kuffar to get ahead while we are living behind. Now we need to compete with them in these modern technologies for the da'wah of Islam. But when it comes to the deen, No, Habibi. No, I will not adapt some, you know, brand new understanding of Islam by Mawlana Batiqa, who they discovered a few years ago with this imamah from here to Chinatown. They give him a big imamah and give him a minbar to scream on, khalas, this is Islam, la wallah. La, we will go back to way back. Way back. How they understood it, we will understand it. If the Sahaba lived for the Quran and the Sunnah, you better believe we will live for the Quran and the Sunnah. And we will never deny them. There were some statements of the Salaf which I wanted to quote to you, just so we can end the lecture with them, just so you know the position they were upon. You all know the incident of the Riddah, when the Prophet ﷺ died and the Arabs apostated. And then some of them said, we will not pay the zakat. We will not pay the zakat. And so Abu Bakr said, wallahi, I will fight them. I will fight them even if they prevent from me the igal, which they used to, and the igal back then, it wasn't for wearing it on the, you know, the shimar. They used it to tie the camel's leg, so the camel would not be able to run away. Now it became a little more advanced. So he said, I will not let them get away with the ijab they used to pay to the Messenger of Allah. So Umar said, but how would you, he said, I will fight anyone who divides between the salah and the zakah. I will fight anyone who divides between salah and zakah, because Allah didn't divide between them. Umar said, but didn't the Messenger of Allah say, I was commanded to fight the people until they say, La ilaha illallah. But when they say, they will protect their wealth and their blood from me, إِلَّا بِحَقِّهَا except بِحَقِّهَا إِلَّا. He said, verily that zakah is from the haqq, from the due right of La ilaha illallah. Then he made that statement. Again, using the sunnah as authority. When Uthman radiallahu anhu said that you shouldn't do Umrah to Hajj, and the news came to Ali, and he said that Uthman said that you shouldn't do that, ijtihad from Khalifa, from the Khulafa al-Rashidin, Ali radiallahu anhu ahalla bil Umrah wal Hajj. After he heard that, he made he entered into the state of ihram by doing ihram for Hajj and Umrah. He said, "La, I will never leave the Sunnah of the Messenger of Allah عليه السلام for anyone. Even if it's Uthman, I will not leave it for anyone." And many time doesn't allow me. Many statements of the righteous predecessors to the effect that the Sunnah is beloved, is precious, is authoritative, and this is the position which every Muslim should hold. So, in your on daily basis, be careful of these individuals out there, and make sure you protect yourself. And to simplify it, if you're unable to give him this whole lecture, very basic answer to any Quranite or Qurani, say, listen, tell me where in the Quran Allah said to pray Dhuhr for rak'at, and to begin with takbirat al-ihram, and to end with taslim, and to recite Surah al-Fatiha, and to recite a surah after, and to say Subhanahu Rabbi al-Azim al-Ruku', find me. Find me in the Quran where it says how to perform Hajj in detail and Umrah. Show me in the Quran how to know the 2.5% for the zakah on mal and on other things. Fine, give me answers. If they are able to give you answers, say then where are you getting your religion from? What kind of Islam are you following? Because these you don't know except from the Sunnah. So that is the actual silencing refutation for anyone who wants to reject the Quran and the Sunnah of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Ask Allah Azza wa Jalla to enable us to live according to the Quran and the Sunnah and the understanding of the righteous predecessors. وجزاكم الله خيرا وصلى الله وسلم على النبي.